Alex, top man, cheers for joining me. Back at Griffin Park, we go for a little trip down memory lane. Let's start though, where it all started for you with Brentford. How did the move come about?
I was at Newmarket Town. It was Eastern Counties League. Yeah, I'd scored like 4 hat-tricks in 3 games.
So you scored 2 hat-tricks in one match, that means, at one point. 6-1.
And then, I had a few scouts coming down to watch, but the manager would always say, this person's coming down, this person's coming down. And the chief scout that was actually here, John Griffin.
Yeah.
He used to come and watch a few times, and luckily, although I was having trials at Ipswich, Norwich, he was quite good with me. He said, look, no matter what, there'll always be chance here. He goes, without a trial, we want to sign you.
Playing in non-league football to go into a pro club must be quite an intimidating and quite nerve-wracking thing.
Yeah, it is. Luckily, like I said, going on trial, I had a few experiences, but coming in, my first day in, we were at Tolworth training, and I remember walking in, and I was with John Griffin, walking past Wally Downs, and he was like, so who's this? And I was like,
oh, cheers.
John was saying, well, you've just signed him, a new player. Yeah. So I was like, oh, bloody hell.
What, great start.
Yeah.
Right, so let's sit down. So this was it. Bournemouth game. I imagine there's a lot going on. I imagine that Martin went on some Shakespearean, inspirational, motivational, big quote speech.
No, I'd say he was very relaxed. Music was on. He was doing his normal look around the changing room, looking at players to see what kind of attitude they have. He had like lots of wit that was there with him as well, that would look after the players, make sure they had what they had. It was a case of, look, we know what we've got to do. I think everybody knew as well, it's like, win, that's all that mattered. He had this vision in his head, and he was kind of playing his vision in his head, but he wasn't actually sharing it with anyone. So he would stand there and he'd just be smiling at himself. He'd be like, when he actually said, right, go warm up, I'm shaking as I'm walking up. I'm thinking, right, just warm up properly, just get it done. I don't think I actually touched the ball until near enough around the time when I actually scored. I think I touched the ball about 3 or 4 times.
You say at the time you scored, I think it's time you should go and relive that moment.
Yeah.
Let's go. Come on, mate. Let's go do it. See, I remember you kind of took a touch. Hang on,
with the outside of my boot.
Yeah.
So we took the corner.
Yeah.
I think they've headed it back out. And I remember Sonko being kind of like half and half. And him just doing some kind of diving header. I think he was trying to put it back in the box.
Right.
But for some reason, me being a youngster, watching like the likes of Henry, and I thought, I'm going to try something out of the ordinary. And I've beat the defender. Go. And I remember them coming towards me and thinking, like, get a shot off before someone does anything.
The moments of that going like slow motion?
They're slow, but the goal shrinks, the goalkeeper gets bigger. So I got quite lucky that when I hit it, the last minute it kind of bounced up, went through Mossy's hands, and all of a sudden it's gone in, that's it. My dad, I think the last time he watched me play a game of football was, I was about 15.
Yeah.
Because I never used to like him coming to watch me play football. I just said, no, do you know what? But it was actually the club that actually rung him up and got him tickets.
Oh, amazing.
So I never even knew he was here. So obviously scoring and the fans.
Yeah, immense.
Seeing me on top of their shoulders and stuff. And as I was walking off, I just kind of looked up and I was like, what are you doing here? And I burst out crying. I was like, best feeling in the world. Like,
yeah. Talk to me about Alex the player.
He was extremely quick, unbelievable pace. But the thing that stood out was his attitude, especially when he was injured.
Yeah.
He stuck around it, kept positive, had a smile on his face, even though it was some, you know, dark times as well. But I think we had a good group of people around as well.
You talk about those, the people around you guys in the changing room. Tell me about the characters in that dressing room.
Hutch, 100%.
Yeah.
Hutch was one.
Love
Hutch. He could come in no matter what. It was his,
what was his nickname?
One-liners, weren't it?
Because he used to stand on his, he used to be in the changing room, have his foot up on the thing, innit?
Yeah,
and wait for Lloyd
to come in. And we just grill, because Lloyd, nicest bloke in the world, but his clobber was awful. He'd go jean on jean. It was like
double denim.
Yeah, and it would be like, he'd walk in, you'd be like, oh God, what's going on here? People would tie his stuff up and that's it, he'd go off and he'd be like, walk in wardrobe.
Hutch would be just waiting for him, where is he?
You were telling me something about Lloyd's pre-match that you would do.
Oh.
Pace, power, precision, isn't it?
It's a routine, and I'm laughing. In my head, I'm like, this is ridiculous. But he used to, like, shirt off, match shirt off.
Was it against the wall?
Against the wall, and he'd be like, pace, power.
Was he screaming?
Strength.
Salts.
And then he would only take a chewing gum off the physio. Damien.
Damien.
Damien, salts.
So Alex, another thing we've got to talk about was the injury, obviously, in that Walsall game. Whereabouts was it? Because I can't remember it being on the touchline.
Yeah, it was pretty much where we are now. My knee went, from the initial challenge, my knee went, and as I've rolled, because the pitch, it was a little bit closer that in them days, straight in, I'm trying to hold my knee at the same time because I knew it is.
You knew straight away it was bad?
Yeah, you could actually do that with my leg because the ligaments were completely snapped. It went my ACL, my LCL, and I burst the Bakers behind the knee as well. So it weren't just one injury, I had three or four bits going on. I mean, I was in pieces, I didn't know what to do straight away. It was like, is this my career?
Yeah, of course.
And the physio at the time, the face he was pulling, it was kind of like, I have no idea where this is going. And Martin's words were, like, you might not ever get back from this. I remember, obviously, thinking, well, that's it, that's me done. What do I do from there? But the club, they stuck by me. Obviously, it took 15 months to get back. And my first game back was Bristol City. And I remember coming on and the fans were amazing. It's times like that where you realise that you were at a good club.
So Alex, we're in the technical area, so it's only fit that we talk about some of the gaffers you worked under. We've touched on Martin already. What about the other managers? Wally Downs, you were a senior.
I say Wally was good, like obviously, first going in not knowing who I was. But yeah, he was lively. I think you kind of knew what you were getting with Wally as well. He was a very good coach. Very good coach, defensive coach, and he knew his stuff.
What made him good as a coach? Because I've heard so many people in the game say what a good coach what he was.
He was very particular. He like you do now where you get your pro zones, you get certain people that analyse in certain parts of the game. He was the one person in that era that would do it all. Vinny come in one time and...
Vinny Jones.
Yeah, we didn't even touch a ball. I think we kind of played rugby. I think Ben May got a black eye as well that day as well.
That's one man I would not want to play rugby against, Vinny Jones.
Do you know what? Lively, smile on his face, just laughing. And over at Tolworth, it's a big area and literally just running around, having a laugh and a joke.
We've spoken a lot about Martin. What was he like with you and in particular? Did he bring your game on in any way? And
I'm not going to lie, he was tough on me. Maybe it's because he saw something that others didn't, and he just wanted the best for me. And yeah, he would say to me if I was doing well in training, if I'd done something where he thought, you know what, he would actually stop and go, that's how it should be done, that's brilliant.
Yeah,
and you do, you thrive off of things like that.
After Martin, obviously Leroy Rossignol comes in, and he's someone who did really well at Torquay. And what was he like to work with?
He was okay. He was a different person to Martin. When Leroy come in, things had changed, like the more balls, more technical. We didn't know how to cope with it, quite frankly. We were like, well, this is completely different. This is not what we know. Like, as a Brentford team, it was work hard, get behind the ball, and that's all we knew. So changing things up. He was a good manager. He was quiet at times. Then he'd have a laugh and a joke. I don't think the players really knew how to cope with it, really.
Alex, lovely little trip down memory lane with a special guest, Marcus Gale. Always fond memories of that goal and your time at Brentford, and the fans love you, and it's been an absolute pleasure. Thanks for getting involved.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure as well, definitely.